What up, YouTube? It's time to brew some beer. What I actually want to do today is a beginner's sort of video going over my entire brew system from top to bottom and explaining the parts of it. So let's check this out.
Let's start with the basics of a three vessel system. You have a hot liquid tank, you have your mash tun, and then your third pot is your boil kettle. In my system, all three of these are the Bayou Classics. I love these. They're affordable, they're stainless steel, so they're easy to clean. Doing this on a budget, it's a nice pot to deal with. All of these are the same, it looks good. Thermal properties of all of them are about the same because it's the same pot. Your hot liquid tank contains water, and it also contains your Herm's coil. Your mash tun is just a simple tank that is used to hold the mash, put in all your grains, and keep that at temperature to extract the sugars and do all the proper conversions during your mash. Then your boil kettle is exactly what it sounds like. That's the kettle that you boil in. If you're using a chiller, which I am in my system, that's what you chill the final product in before you put it into the fermenter to start ferment your beer. The next major component of my system is the plumbing. I am using a two pump system. I do have a third pump, but that is a duplicate pump from the old stuff, and that is just used for the whirlpool. I could use either one of these pumps for the whirlpool. But in this system, this is a one tier, three vessel, two pump system. Probably the most basic of the more advanced systems that you could set up. I have one pump, which is my water pump. This pump is dedicated to pulling from the water tank. The only thing that's ever going into this pump is hot water. Your other pump is your wort pump, and this one is pulling from the mash tun. The water pump, while you're heating the water, just recirculates the water from the bottom of the water vessel up to the top. I have an angle bracket in here which helps this to swirl, and all that does is make it so that this water heats up much more evenly and quicker than it was if it was just sitting. You want your water in your water tank to be moving because it's going to help it to heat up quicker because it's constantly circulating the water. Identical pumps, so the flow rates are the same. And the way the flow goes, the water pump pulls in from the water tank. I use the three-way valve here to direct where the water goes. When the handle's in this direction, it's pushing the water back into the top of the water tank for circulation. And when I flip this three-way valve over, it is now pushing the water down into this T. This T feeds the Herm's coil, pushes out at the top, and then that goes into the mash tun. Once I switch over to mashing, I flip this valve to push the water into this T. That will fill my mash tun with my strike water. And through a setup of this system, I can actually also fill it from the bottom below the mesh that's in the bottom of the mash tun. Because there's a mesh down in the bottom of your mash tun that makes it so that your grains don't get sucked through your lines. It helps to set the grain bed. It keeps your pumps from clogging, keeps your lines from clogging. You can use a sock on it, a mesh sock, a steel mesh sock. But the best setup is a mesh bottom that keeps clear wort going through and being pulled out into the pump, and helps to set your grain bed evenly. When this pump is running, it's pulling from the mash tun, and when I'm using it for a recirculation in order to keep my mash at temperature, it's feeding into the tea. It's closed off to this side because this pump is now feeding the water tank just for recirculation. It pushes the wort back into the coil, which helps to keep to maintain the temperature of the wort, and then puts it back in the top of the mash tun. And that is my recirculation whenever I'm actually mashing. When it comes time to sparge, this handle gets redirected over to pull from the mash tun and feed to the boil kettle. And then I use the valve on the actual mash tun to control the flow rate. You want to drain slowly. You don't want to drain too quick. And in my experience, if you drain real, real quick, it actually does lower your efficiency in your mash. And then I fill this up with the first runoff in a batch sparge. After that, I will redo the setup for moving water back into the mash tun. I will add the proper amount of water to the grain bed for the second runoff. I circulate it for about 5 to 10 minutes to help it set the grain bed. And then I do the same thing. I run off the rest of my wort into the boil kettle, at which point in time, this whole side of the system can just be cleaned. And I boil for 60 minutes, whatever my boil time is. I hook my whirlpool pump up to the boil kettle, kick that on to whirlpool at the end of it, put in my immersion chiller, chill the wort, put in the fermenter. This is the brains of the operation. This is my controller. I bought this through Electric Brew Supply. Shout out to them. It's a fantastic controller. I've done a couple batches with it, and I love it for convenience. This controls the hot liquid tank heating element.
This controls the boil kettle heating element. This selects which heating element is firing. You set the temperature on this gauge here, and it will hold that temperature by cycling the heating element on and off to make sure that it's keeping the set temperature. Your boil kettle functions the same way. You also put your boil element into percentage mode. You set this to 55, and it will fire at 55%, and it will keep your boil going. Each one of these tanks in the back of them has a temperature probe, which goes to the controller. It lets it know what temperature the water is in the hot liquid tank, the mash tun, and also your boil kettle. Two of these vessels, the boil kettle and the hot liquid tank, also have a heating element in the bottom. Down there is the bottle, the 5,500 watt ripple element. This whole system I have for electric is 240, and you can clearly see my Herms coil in there as well. So it's a stainless steel coil, allows the heat to transfer to work. I have twist locks on these so that I can remove those from the pot itself, so that this wire that connects the electronic controller can just be disconnected from both sides, and then I can hang it on my walls for storage. I did weldless connections on all my pots for everything, for the temperature probes, all the valves. I did weldless fittings. I haven't had any issues with leaks or anything like that. That's why I stick with them. And I did tri-clamps on these so that I can remove the heating elements to replace them easily, and also to clean the one that's in the boil kettle if it gets bad. The last step of the boil process is a immersion chiller. This hooks to a hose. Cold water runs through the coil. You put that in your boil kettle. It hangs from the side on mine because I don't want it sitting on top of the heating element. You run cold hose water inside the coil while I run my whirlpool pump to swirl the boiled wort to chill it down to yeast pitch temperature. You don't have to crack to fast chill your beer, but it cuts out a lot of problems. In my opinion, the cheapest and the easiest to run and to keep clean, because you're just cleaning the outside of that. You don't care about the inside. It's just hose water used for cooling. You're cleaning the outside of that, and that's it. The other advantage of using this is you don't need an additional pump. If you are doing a simpler system where you don't have another pump, you can use this with the pressure of a hose to chill. And if you don't have a pump for whirlpool, you could just stir your boil. I mean, you don't have to, it'll still chill, but you could stir it to make it chill faster. The last part and the most sophisticated part is my deep sink. This is really high speed. You get a bucket, you drill out a hose connection, you run the hose down your driveway or to some other low point. I'm lucky my driveway slopes down towards the drainage system in my cul-de-sac. And then you have yourself a deep sink for pouring out your dirty water, pouring out your rinse water, your soapy water. I do use this when I'm cleaning my pots, but I dump my grains into a grain bag, because obviously you don't want to just run all your grains out of your driveway because they're going to sit there forever.
Nice thing about having a temperature gauge in the boil kettle is I can watch my temperature as it drops down to know when I'm done chilling.
Ladies and gentlemen, that is my brew system top to bottom. If I missed anything, or if you guys are confused on any of this, hit me up in the comments. I'll definitely reply and try and get back to you. Also, all my other brewers out there, if you have any tips that you guys know of things to streamline this or even little enhancements that I can do, hit me up in the comments as well. I'm always looking to expand my brew knowledge and grow. And as always, keep brewing.